God to evermore be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure to give His place. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. Oh, 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 we shout out your praise. Oh, 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 we sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. See, He hung upon that cross, and He rose up from that grave. My God, still all it stole away. So we sing in church. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure to give His place. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Sing it out, church. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. The prisoner, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is sure to give His place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. If we won't be quiet, we shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh.
Thank you, God. We love you. You can have a seat. Thank you, church.
This is Miss Abigail Hagen. And when Jesus talks about all of us needing to be like little children to come into heaven, I think about that when Abby comes in. If you see, she has those big brown eyes. And she has such joy. And she comes running in each service. And I just picture that being how Christ wants us to just throughout our whole lives continually come to Him with the just innocence and joy like Abby. Yeah. And so she has decided to commit her life to Christ and to follow Him all the days of her life. And so Abby, I'm going to have you come over here. And Abby, I'm going to have you say the confession.
No, I don't know.
Yes, that believers have been saying since the beginning of the church. Okay, stand up and come right over here. And you're going to repeat after me. I believe that Jesus is the Christ.
That Jesus is the Christ.
The Son of the living God.
The Son of the living God.
And I accept him.
I accept him.
As my Lord.
As my Lord.
And Savior.
And Savior.
Okay. Because of your repentance and confession of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Man, thanks so much for being here today. Welcome. We're so glad that you are here to be a part of our worship today. We're continuing our series on parenting today, okay? And I saw an Instagram video. It was probably 2 weeks ago. And it happened in a high school classroom. And obviously, as soon as this started to unfold, one of the students slipped out his phone and began to film. The teacher had a rule that if your phone rings during class and it interrupts the class, you have to answer it on speakerphone, okay? And so right in the middle of class, this girl's phone rang. She's like, oh, no. And she answers the phone, and it says, is this Miss Smith? And she said, yes, it is. And they said, well, this is the such-and-such pregnancy center, and we are calling to let you know that your test was positive. We understand that there's not a father in the picture. We want you to know that we are here to help you. I mean, you should have seen the teacher's face. He is mortified. This poor girl is just ready to crawl under the desk. I mean, it's just a terrible situation. She says, can I please call you back later? And they said yes. And she hung up the phone. And he said, I'm so sorry. I don't even know what to say. I'm so sorry. She said, it's okay. I really expected this. I've already decided I'm going to name the baby April. The middle name is Fools. You should have seen the teacher's face. He exploded in laughter. He said, I will treasure this for the rest of my life. It was the best April Fool's joke of all time. Don't you love teenagers? If only they would take all that energy and put it into learning, you know, or cleaning their room or something, right? But man, so creative, so fun. We're going to talk about the teen years today and what it's like being a parent of a teenager, a little bit about what it's like to be a teenager. And just hopefully, whether you're a grandparent, aunt, uncle, friend, we are all in this together, passing on the faith to the next generation, and I think we're going to learn some good things today. Okay, let's pray. God, thank you for your love. Thank you for your grace to us. Thank you for multiple generations who come together, and we get to just to share your truth and pass on the legacy of faith, and I pray that we do that well. Lord, would you speak to us today? Help us to have open hearts and minds for what we need to hear. And just thank you that we are a family and that we love and care about each other. Thanks for adopting us as your children, Lord. Thank you for this beautiful picture of baptism we got to see of how you wash us clean and give us a new start. Whether we do that as a young child or as a senior adult, it's just this beautiful privilege of surrendering to you. And so we just pray all this, thanking you and praising you. In Christ's name, amen.
Sheriff, it's an honor. Where's Opie?
He's in school.
Drag up someone and sit down. I'm making a new fish lure. I gave the other one I had to Opie.
Yeah, he showed it to me when he told me about the chicken dinner.
Well, that, too bad about that poor bird. Run down the middle of the road by a new sports car. I tried to get the license number, but you understand all that dust and everything.
What run over the pie?
The pie was the pie.
Well, that's not why I'm here.
Good.
It's about Opie.
Something wrong?
Yeah, there's something wrong.
He ate too much?
No, it goes a little deeper than that.
Well, what is it? You know, I've grown awful fond of that young fellow. What's wrong?
Well, there seems to be something wrong with his thinking. He's gotten a little twisted on things lately. Like being able to tell the difference between right and wrong.
Oh.
Not that that's an easy thing. A lot of grown-ups still struggling with that same problem. But it's especially difficult for a youngster. because things rub off on him so easy.
I see. You're suggesting that maybe I'm not fit company for Opie?
That would seem to be the case.
Well, Sheriff, maybe I do look at things differently than other people. Is that wrong? I live by my wits. I'm not above bending the law now and then to keep clothes on my back or food in my stomach. I live the kind of life that other people would just love to live if they only had the courage. Who's to say that the boy would be happier your way or mine? Why not let him decide?
No, I'm afraid it don't work that way. You can't let a young'un decide for himself. He'll grab at the first flashy thing with shiny ribbons on it. Then when he finds out there's a hook in it, it's too late. The wrong ideas come packaged with so much glitter, it's hard to convince him that other things might be better in the long run. And all a parent can do is say, wait, trust me, and try to keep temptation away.
That means that you're inviting me to leave.
That's right.
Well, you're wearing a badge, so I leave. That wasn't so difficult. Your problem solved.
That's where you're wrong. That boy thinks just about everything you do is perfect. So my problem's just beginning. You've left behind an awful lot of unscrambling to be done.
Now look here.
Goodbye, Mr. Dave.
Well, we are continuing our series today, Setting a Course, Principles on Parenting. That clip from the old Andy Griffith show reminds us that there are different stages of parenting, and parents have to handle things differently according to what stage they're in. You know, it goes all the way back to prenatal care, right? Before the child's even born, mom and dad want to be healthy physically, they want to be healthy emotionally so that the baby has the best chance for a strong start. And then there's nurturing a newborn. Providing care for infants and then toddlers. There's feeding and bathing and teething and sleeping and not sleeping and diapers. Well, none of that is what this series is about. It's when a child is about 18 months old to 2 years that these compass principles really start to kick in. Now, we don't stop caring for children, obviously, meeting their needs. But what we find is that we have to guide them as well as provide for them. Gail and I heard years ago that there are 4 primary stages of child rearing and 4 different ways that parents should handle those stages. The preschool years, approximately ages 2 to 5, that's the discipline stage. During that time, parents establish authority. They help kids learn the difference between right and wrong. Right? The hope of every parent during that stage is obey me. Don't just listen to what I have to say. I want you to actually do it. And then from ages 6 to 12, parents are in the training stage. Here, parents walk along with their kids. They show them how to make decisions, how to relate to other people, how to deal with conflict and anger, joy, disappointment. And the hope of parents at this stage is follow me, right? Do as I do, which puts tremendous responsibility on us as adults to set a good example if we're going to be inviting them to follow along. The teen years from 13 to 19 bring the coaching stage. When you think about sports, a team might train for months, but once the season starts, the coach can't just walk out onto the field or onto the court and go back and start teaching fundamentals again, right? They call in plays from the sidelines. And once kids hit their teen years, especially as they progress through those years, parents do more calling in plays from the sidelines. I mean, there's still a lot of parenting to do. Parents are still actively involved in kids' lives. But Sheriff Taylor, from that Andy Griffith clip that we watched, he would have handled the situation differently if Opie had been Richie Cunningham, right? If he had been a teenager, it would have looked different than him being a young boy. We deal with kids differently as they mature. Once our children are in their 20s and beyond, we're in the friendship stage, what I like to think of as the legacy stage. We relate to them as adults, and we watch as they begin the process, maybe of having kids of their own. Doesn't always happen, but oftentimes it does. I heard about a young minister fresh out of seminary, and he preached a series one time on parenting. He called it the Ten Commandments of child rearing. Then he had a couple of kids. And a few years later, he did another parenting series. He called it Five Suggestions for Child Rearing. And then he had teenagers. He preached one sermon, fasten your seatbelt and hold on tight. You know, ironically, as parents, the more experience that we have, often the less equipped we feel. And so what I want to do today is show you some principles from the wisest man who ever lived, the wisest besides Jesus Christ. We're going to see today that he offered his children some amazing insights, great advice, and yet things did not work out like he hoped that they would. And it's kind of a reminder that parenting is hard, that it's uncertain. Sometimes it's heartbreaking. So why do we do it? Well, because it can also be the most rewarding job in the world. King David was a great king in Israel. For all of his faults, and he had many, Israel was strongest when he was on the throne. That was about 1000 BC. David was a warrior king. He united the kingdom. He secured Israel's borders. He pointed people to the Lord. David's son Solomon then succeeded him on the throne. And so God came to Solomon and offered to grant him one request. Any request. Now, he couldn't say, I want 1,000 more requests. Okay, well, you get one, Solomon, okay? And it was almost like a genie in a bottle. No kidding. God just said, Solomon, I'll grant you anything you ask for. And Solomon did not ask for power. He did not ask for riches. He asked for wisdom. And you say, man, what a great answer. His father David must have done something right. And friends, he did. Listen to how Solomon described his own childhood in Proverbs 4:3. He said, when I was a boy in my father's house, still tender and only child of my mother, he taught me and he said, lay hold of my words with all your heart. Keep my commands and you will live. Get wisdom. Get understanding. Do not forget my words or swerve from them. Do not forsake wisdom, and she will protect you. Love her, and she will watch over you. Wisdom is supreme. Therefore, get wisdom, though it cost all that you have. Get understanding. David convinced his son Solomon that wisdom was supreme. And so when God offered Solomon anything he could think of, Solomon chose wisdom. And man, God just made him unbelievably wise. News of his knowledge and insight, man, it spread far and wide. Kings, queens, and crowds would come just to listen to him talk. He was a brilliant writer. He wrote at least 2 of the Psalms in the New Testament. He wrote most of the book of Proverbs. Also, he wrote Ecclesiastes and the Song of Solomon. This is a well-coached kid who became a brilliant leader. I want to show you some of his wisdom today. But before we dive into this text that he wrote, man, I just want to say, I love teenagers. I really do. I've known probably thousands of teenagers. I've worked with dozens, maybe hundreds of them. I raised 3 of them. And I know that it's challenging. I know that it can be amazing. I know that it's scary. Sometimes it's frustrating. It can be heartbreaking. Parenting teenagers enhanced my prayer life, okay? I will admit to you that if there was a camera in our house on a few occasions over the years, you probably would not think I have any business preaching this message today because, man, a lot of failure on my part when it came to parenting. But the teen years, so rewarding too. We loved interacting with our kids at that age. We loved having their friends over. You know, we took extra kids on vacation sometimes during those years. Our sons had a friend named Kyle. He spent the night at our house so often, we just had his toothbrush in our bathroom with all the others, you know, because you never knew when Kyle was gonna stick around. Our daughter, Mackenzie, had a friend. Man, she was just hilarious. And she would just say the most unexpected things. She got on this kick for a while where we would be sitting down to eat, and she'd say something like, Mr. Jones, be a doll and pass me the green beans. It's like, where does that come from? But she was just always coming up with stuff like that. We loved their friends. We loved those years. They would make movies, just all the crazy stuff. During the teen years, think about it, you get to watch your children develop into adults. You get to watch them become more and more independent as they learn to navigate life on their own. You go from making decisions for them when they're young to helping them make decisions to watching them make decisions. All the discipline and training that we've talked about the last 2 weeks start to pay off. So I want you to know, I'm not down on teenagers. I'm not going to tell you what's wrong with these kids today. I don't want to paint some sad and scary picture for you, but I do want to be honest. And I want to talk about some responsibilities that we have as parents and grandparents, some pitfalls we need to avoid, hopefully wrap up with some encouragement about life on the other side of those years. Solomon wrote this to his son in Proverbs 4:10. Listen, my son, accept what I say, and the years of your life will be many. I guide you in the way of wisdom, and I lead you along straight paths. Sometimes coaching involves words. Listen, my son, accept what I say. Sometimes it involves leading from out in front. I lead you along straight paths. The implication is follow along. And then sometimes coaching involves guidance from the sidelines. I guide you in the way of wisdom. I mean, think of it like this. Sometimes coaches send in plays from the sidelines, but sometimes they got to call a timeout and kind of regroup for some reason, right? They might give a locker room talk before the game. They have a halftime talk with the team. At the end of the game, they celebrate the team's victory, and man, they comfort and they encourage a team's defeat. I've told you how much I love March Madness. Man, the NCAA basketball tournament is my favorite time of year sports-wise. It starts with 68 teams. It gets down to one ultimate winner. And what that means is that 67 head coaches all end up talking to their teams after a devastating loss. And what a coach says in those moments is a lot more important than what they say while the team is cutting down the nets and they're receiving the winner's trophy. Coaching is about guidance. It's about influence. It's about imparting wisdom. If parents say, obey me during the discipline stage, and they say, follow me during the training stage, during the coaching stage, they say, trust me. I really am on your side. I really am here to help you. I don't want to ruin your life. I want to make it better. I guide you in the way of wisdom, Solomon says. I lead you along straight paths. As I was studying through Proverbs chapter 4 this week, I noticed these verses about what it looks like to offer guidance to teenagers. Solomon's writing to his sons. He says, and I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. I really like this translation of these verses. Proverbs 4:23, he says, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Look straight ahead and fix your eyes on what lies before you. Mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path. Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from following evil. Solomon says for his sons, for his children, that they need to guard their hearts, they need to guard their mouths, they need to guard their eyes, and they need to guard their feet. And I want to think about those things for just a minute. First, guard your heart. He says the heart determines the course of your life. I've heard this verse explained, the heart is the command center of your life. Now, we know that our brains really call the shots and make the decisions, but the heart suggests both the essence of physical life, right, in our bodies. The heart pumps the blood that keeps us alive. We check for someone's pulse as proof of life. But the heart also suggests the emotions, the intellect, the will, who we are deep down inside. Guard what you think about, Solomon is saying. Guard what you long for. Guard how you respond to intense emotions like anger or depression, loneliness, grief, disappointment, self-loathing, or self-love. Guard your heart because all of life is going to flow out of your thoughts and your emotions and the longings of your heart. Next, he says, guard your mouth. Avoid all perverse talk. Stay away from corrupt speech. Jesus said in the New Testament that from the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. What comes out your mouth starts out in here. Part of the parenting process is paying attention to words. The words that we say as parents, the words that we allow our kids to say, the words that we exchange with each other. When your teen gets louder and louder, I mean, you can get louder too. Or you can get softer. And you can get softer. And you can try to de-escalate things and bring things down a notch. If your son or daughter accidentally kicks the coffee table and says a word that you might not hear in a sermon, you know, you might choose to address that. You also might recognize that, ironically, that was the exact same word you said the last time you kicked the coffee table. But when your child is being disrespectful, caustic to mom, being aggressive toward a younger sibling, being rude to a teacher, man, you got to step in and intervene. You got to call a timeout and say, that is not acceptable behavior. Stay away from corrupt speech. Avoid perverse talk because words matter. Solomon also suggests guard your eyes. Verse 25, look straight ahead. Fix your eyes on what lies before you. The assumption here in Proverbs is that we need to watch where we're going. And as parents, we can help our kids watch. Right? We all need to pay attention. We need to focus our eyes, our minds, on things that are constructive, things that are healthy, things that are God-honoring. I mean, let's be honest. We live in a sex-saturated society. There's internet pornography, texting, sexual images, posting selfies on social media that are highly suggestive. There are teenagers today, you know this, that have committed suicide because of shame. Images they thought were going to be private suddenly were made public. And you would like to think that parents are right there helping and guiding and coaching, but sometimes parents are the problem. I read an article last month from the New York Times about a group of Instagram accounts. Somewhere around 5,000 of them in this group, the girls in the pictures are too young to be on Instagram themselves, and so their guardians, most of them their moms, are posting pictures of their girls dressed up pretty, sometimes dressed up sexy. And the goal is to get more and more views, sometimes millions of views, because they're hoping for modeling contracts for their girls. Never mind that child predators are stalking these sites. Never mind that these 5,000 accounts are being followed by 32 million men. Never mind that these girls are often the talk of illegal anonymous pedophile websites. And you say, who's protecting our kids? See, what we see leads to where we go. And what's true for teenagers is also true for parents. And so we help our kids focus on what's wise, that they're headed in the right direction. It's why Solomon also says to guard your feet. Proverbs 4:26, mark out a straight path for your feet. Stay on the safe path. Don't get sidetracked. Keep your feet from following evil. It's what Andy Stanley calls the principle of the path. That everybody is on a path and we're all heading somewhere. Wisdom means looking far enough down the path to make sure that where that path is heading is where you want to go and where you want to end up. A lot of us aren't very good at looking very far down the road. I mean, you think, again, we think about the culture we live in today. So much talk about things like premarital sex, safe sex, casual sex, friends with benefits, hooking up. And it reminds me, one afternoon, I walked into a drugstore and I saw a teenage girl in there, and I don't ever remember seeing someone with a more desperate, panicked look on their face. I almost asked her if she was okay, but I figured some creepy guy asking if she was okay would just freak her out even more. So I kind of from a distance just paid attention, made sure she was all right. And she stared at the shelf, it felt like for a couple of minutes. And then she grabbed a box and she rushed off to the counter with tears coming down her face. And after she was gone, I walked by and glanced. Of course it was pregnancy tests. Of course it was. There's a reason the Bible talks about saving sex for marriage. I mean, that's a joke today. It's not just about the possibility of pregnancy. It's about cultivating self-control. It's about staying healthy emotionally. It's about dating to build emotional and spiritual connection, not a sexual connection. Purity before marriage is about honoring your future marriage. You actually can enter a marriage covenant with an exclusive sexual relationship. Smart parents help their kids establish boundaries like that. They help them make wise choices, not just sexually, but in all areas of life, getting on the right path. And so Solomon here is showing us in how we help our kids. Guard your heart. Guard your mouth. Guard your eyes. Guard your feet. We do that ourselves. We help them do it too. Now, to be fair, I want you to know that as wise as Solomon was, as much good advice as he gave to his kids, things did not turn out very well, at least not with his successor to the throne. Solomon's example, for one thing, was not always godly. He got himself into all kinds of trouble, smart as he was. And 1 Kings 12 shows us what happened when his son Rehoboam took over the kingdom. Rehoboam went to the town of Shechem, where he was crowned king of Israel. And when the leaders from the tribes of Israel came to him, they said to Rehoboam, "Your father Solomon was a hard master. If you will just lighten the load a bit, we will be your loyal subjects." And so Rehoboam did a very wise thing. He brought in his father's counselors, these men who were farther down the road, who had seen more of life, lots of experience. And he asked them, "What should I do?" And they said, "If you serve these people and you honor their request and you negotiate and, you know, work with them, man, they will serve you faithfully." But the Bible says Rehoboam rejected their advice. Instead, he went to his friends, the guys he grew up with, his drinking buddies, and he asked their advice. This is what they said in 1 Kings 12:10. "This is what you should tell those complainers who want a lighter load or a lighter burden. My little finger is thicker than my father's waist. Yes, my father laid heavy burdens on you, but I'm going to make them even heavier. My father beat you with whips. I will beat you with scorpions." And Rehoboam liked the sound of that. So he followed their advice. And the kingdom of Israel was split in two. Israel in the north, Judah in the south. Rehoboam ruled in Judah, and he began a line of kings, some good, most bad. And ultimately Israel and then Judah fell to the Assyrians and then the Babylonians. Man, it's just, it's hard to imagine how history might have been different if Rehoboam had simply followed the wise advice of his father and of his elders, who could see farther down the road, who knew what was coming, had seen more of life. Parents, I want you to understand, sometimes teens, sometimes young adults choose the wrong path. Things may turn around later on. Sometimes they don't. Often they do. It's why we discipline. It's why we train. It's why we coach. Because we want to parent to the best of our ability. We want to pray like crazy. We lay a foundation of faithfulness for them so they have the best possible chance of a godly life. We set an example they can follow. We do everything to build on the relationship we have, keep those lines of communication open. I mean, think about it. The teen years involve increased independence for them and gradual releasing on our part. That's what we're going to talk about next Sunday, is this whole releasing process. But it is essential that we do everything in our power to have a healthy relationship with our teens. These coaching years need a mom's and a dad's wise influence. Our best opportunity to navigate these years is to invest in the relationship. That's our best opportunity to help them navigate these hard years, is that we pour into them and we invest in the relationship with them. And that means that we support their interests, as long as they're healthy interests. It means that we step into their world once in a while. We find out what they like. We ask them to show us their favorite video game so they can clobber us at it. We want to hear what their favorite songs are. It goes beyond, did you have a good day? Yep. What'd you do at school? Nothing. Anything I need to know? Nope. Good talk. Let's do this again tomorrow. Man, I remember those years. We have to look for ways to engage, to stay connected, to step into their world without invading their world, okay? If you have teenagers, any of these words sound familiar? Rules, curfew, boundaries, drama, conflict, isolation. These are all battlefields. And so a healthy relationship helps us navigate turbulent waters. Now, parents, before we wrap up, I want to offer you a tool that I think might be helpful, okay? You might want to write this down. You might want to just put it into your phone right now. It's a website, okay? It's axis.org. Axis.org. It's for parents of teens. It talks about news and trends and cultural landmarks and things that relate to the challenges of this generation. There are articles on a number of different issues related to culture and how Christianity and culture work together. I wish this website had been around when our kids were teenagers. I follow it regularly. All right, I want to give you a bottom line for today. And then I want to close with a glimpse at my and Gail's parenting journey that is deeply personal. Bottom line today is this: the foundation for influence is relationship. I mean, as parents, as coaches of our kids, we want to influence them. The foundation for that influence is relationship. If there's no relationship, it's hard to have any kind of constructive influence. Now, from 13 to 19, that's a wide range, and the relationship is going to look different as our kids mature. And if you're not the parent of a teenager, and I'm speaking from personal experience here, if you come alongside parents and you befriend a teenager and you become somebody that's safe, that they can talk to, that they can share with, and you're kind of supporting the parental values, but you're also that safe place, I'm telling you, you can have a great influence. You're like the assistant coach, and it can be really powerful. But the foundation for influence is relationship. Okay. I told you a couple of weeks ago how strong-willed our son Aaron was, especially when he was in his preschool and elementary years. I love that picture because that like sums up those years, okay? I mean, that look right there. His teen years were much simpler because we wore ourselves out being consistent in the early years. And so we hardly had any rules at all for him as a teenager. We hardly had to set any boundaries at all. It's like, where are you going? What time are you going to be home? Let us know if anything changes. And he earned trust, and he was trustworthy. And the same for Daniel. Our greatest challenge during the teen years was our daughter Mackenzie. It was not rebellion, it was brokenness. She didn't run away, she didn't get hooked on drugs, nothing like that at all. Her life was broken in a way that nearly wrecked us. And incidentally, in case this is a worry to you, She gave me permission a long time ago to tell her story. I've told it certainly before. She has stood before groups and shared her story as well. Elementary school for Mackenzie was great. Fifth grade was icing on the cake. That year could not have gone any better. It was a great year. Then came middle school. And she fell in with some toxic friends. And she wasn't even a teenager yet. And suddenly she's being confronted with teen issues and teen problems. She began to believe some things about herself and some things about her body that were just so destructive. And for a long time, we were completely unaware of. We lived in South Carolina, and winters in South Carolina are warmer than here, but they're not shorts and swimsuit kind of weather. Jeans and sweaters and bulky clothes were pretty normal. And as spring gave way to summer that year, I'll never forget, Mackenzie came out of her room in a swimsuit, and I gasped, and Gail started to cry. This little girl, barely an adolescent, and she was 30 pounds underweight. What we found out is that she'd kind of, you know, have a little bit of breakfast with us. She'd throw her lunch away every day. If she was at a friend's house, she wouldn't eat at all. If she was at our house, she'd pick through a little bit of supper. And one day we realized how tragically sick she was. That moment that day began about 6 years of hell for our family. Anorexia, bulimia, cutting stitches, hospital stays, antidepressants, counseling, the relentless fear that we were going to pull in the driveway and find her dead in her room. At mealtime, we would make her eat, and she would sit and sob when we made her put food in her mouth. The therapist at that time was a specialist dealing with girls with eating disorders. He told us we could forget about a clean room and good grades. Our only goal was to keep her alive. It took a year of counseling for her to be able to tell us that her friends at school told her that fat girls get their periods first. And because her little body developed faster than her friends, she hated herself for a long time. And things just got darker and they got harder. And the self-loathing in her life, man, was just overwhelming for our family. And I could go on and on. We finally moved away from South Carolina and went back to Indiana for a number of reasons, but largely because it was such a toxic place for her. We just reached the point where we had to do something drastic, and she would tell you today that if we had not left, she would not be alive today. And friends, I tell you all that because of the healing that we experienced on the other side of those years. Now, I'll be totally candid with you. One of my greatest burdens to this day is her faith journey has been pretty tumultuous, and we pray for her every day. But we moved back to Indiana when she was a teenager, and things began to slowly improve, and she found a measure of peace in her later teen years, and she got some friends and some adults spoke into her life that made things better. She stopped believing a lot of those lies. She found her voice. She found her strengths. She's a great leader at work today. She's a loving wife, a great stepmom. She's a devoted mother today. And if you don't know much about anorexia, one of the concerns is that maybe you can't get pregnant. And Cyrus is just a reminder of healing. Mackenzie has a really loud laugh. I mean, it's just outrageous. And I remember during those late teen years, we had gone to see a Christian comedian. And there were 1,600 people in the room, and he made fun of her laugh twice. And I think I love her laugh so much because we didn't hear it for so long. If you are the parent of a teenager who is hurting and who is broken and who is struggling, maybe it's rebellion, maybe it's just self-loathing, whatever it is, man, don't give up hope. This is a season, but it's not forever. And the prayer, the longing, the hope of our lives is that something is going to happen. There's going to be a new friend. There's going to be somebody come into their lives. They're going to find Christ. And things are going to change. That's the hope that we all live in, is that the reality of today does not have to be the reality of tomorrow. But I just want to remind you that the foundation of the influence that we can have is relationship. And so we stay involved. I mean, man, if the relationship is broken, we take any tiny little bit of foundation that there is. We build on anything. If it's just smoking embers, we blow real gently on those embers. And we do all we can to make a difference. God is not finished working on you or on them. Let's pray. Father, we think about the unbelievable love that you have for us, the grace that you show to us, how deep your love is and how wide open your arms are. We think about that story, I've had it on my mind this week, in the Bible that Jesus told about the son who rebelled and lived his own life and indulged in all kinds of sin, and he hit rock bottom. And he came home expecting maybe a harsh welcome. And instead, the father ran to him and threw his arms around him and loved him. And God, we picture that and we think about ourselves and we think about how broken we've all been, and to know that your grace is that big. And then we think about teenagers today and how hard it is to be a teenager today. And we just think about the challenges they face, and difficulties they deal with, and hard things at school and social media, and how difficult that can make everything. And God, we trust that you are bigger than all that, that you're the answer to all that. And so as parents, as grandparents, as adults, we ask that you'd help us know how to pour into the next generation in a way that can help them navigate this hard, hard life. God, we love you and we thank you for being so good. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.